Good afternoon, students. Today we'll see about nematodes. Among them, we are going to learn about Ascaris lumbricoides and Trichuris trichura today. So, as you all know, helminths, they are divided into mainly two phyla, platyhelminths and nematohelminths. Okay, this has been told in your introduction class already. Platyhelminths, it consists of cestodia, trematodia and monocyne. Next, one more phyla is nematohelminths. So, we have to see in detail about phylum Nematoda. These general characteristics and about this phylum, this has been told in your last class. So this is just to brush up. We'll go for classification. See, there are different types of classification. One is systemic, one more is based on Edgar larva, and one more is based on habitat. Based on Edgar larva, we may call it as oviparous, herbiparous, or ovoviviparous. One more systemic classification, that is class Adenophoria and class Secrinentia. One more is based on habitat, means where they are going to live, their life. So again, this nematodes, based on habitat, that is the place where they live, they are divided into intestinal and tissue nematodes. So intestinal nematodes are large intestinal and small intestinal again. Large intestinal nematodes are Trichuris trichura, Entrobius vermicularis. Whereas small intestinal nematodes are Ascaris lumbricoides, Ankylostomoidea and Nicator americanus. Whereas your tissue nematodes are filarial worms, Ucheria bancrofti, Brugia malai, Loa loa, Oncocercus species, Mansonella species, Trichinella spiralis and Brachinculus medinensis. So in this class, we are going to see about one large intestinal nematode and one small intestinal nematode. That is Trichuris trichura and Ascaris lumbricoides. So Trichuris trichura, it is also called as whip worm because of its shape or the body structure. It is in shape of a whip, so it is called as whip worm. It is a soil transmitted helminth, and its habitat, as I have told you in the classification, it mainly stays in large intestine, that too in the cecum and appendix in most of the individuals. And it causes a disease known as trichuriasis. It is mainly in warm and moist climate. Children are more commonly affected for this infection. As they play with mud and all, their hands may get easily contaminated. So most of the parasitic infections we usually see in children. There will be accidental contamination of egg or larva with the parasite and with the human hands. Then they will take it accidentally without washing or something. So it enters into the intestine of the individual. Global prevalence in humans is approximately about 604 million. See, here the picture you can see, it is in the form of a whip. The shape is like a whip, so it is called as whip worm, and it has all three forms, that is adult worm and larval form, egg. Again, in larval forms, there are four forms. So first we'll see about the morphology of egg. It is a barrel shaped and it is surrounded by a shell. It has a mucus plug at both the holes, hence it has the barrel shape. It measures about 50 to 54 micrometer in length and 20 to 23 micrometer in the width. It is a bile-stained egg and it floats in saturated salt solution. So as I have told in my previous classes also, life cycle means first you have to divide which is the host for this parasite, which is the infective form and what is the mode of transmission. Before writing your whole life cycle picture, you have to write in this headings. So host for this Trichuris is human only. It is having only one host, that is human, whereas the infective form is embryonated eggs. Because these parasites may present in different forms, we should know which is infective form, which is diagnostic form. Here the infective form is embryonated eggs of Trichuris trichura. So mode of transmission is ingestion of contaminated food containing embryonated egg. So we'll see about life cycle now. Man acquires infection by ingestion of contaminated food and water containing embryonated egg. As other parasites, this also like accidental intake. Whichever the eggs, if it is contaminated with the food or water something, we will take it. Then larva is liberated through one of the pole of the egg. That mucus plug will be there, no? Through that the larval form is hatched out. So liberated larva, now it is in the second stage. Once it comes out of the egg, it becomes a second stage larva. It will be present in small intestine. Later it migrates to large intestine. In the large intestine there will be different forms like male, female, and the reproduction occurs. So the adult worms, they will stay in the large intestine itself. After 2 to 3 months, the fertilized female worm lays an embryonated eggs. So there is no embryo in the egg. Such eggs are laid. These eggs are passed through the feces of the infected host. See, here there may be two chances. One is it may directly develop into the embryonated egg, or else it takes around 10 to 14 days and it undergoes some moltings. Moltings means there will be morphological changes in the egg morphology. Then it undergoes, then it gets transformed into embryonated egg. So again you can see the mucus plug, larval form, everything will be there in that embryonated egg. This embryonated egg will be contaminated with the food or water we intake. This is how the cycle repeats. Coming to pathogenicity of the disease, incubation, it has a long incubation period. It varies from 70 to 90 days. And usually the patients who are infected with trichuriasis, they will be asymptomatic. If they have some symptoms, then it will be like eosinophilia. Other common manifestations include abdominal pain, anorexia. And they also present with a syndrome known as Trichuris dysentery syndrome. They are most commonly they are affected by iron deficiency anemia, because in most of the parasites you can see they will be parasite, the name itself suggests that it is taking the nutrition of the individual. So it mainly causes iron deficiency anemia. Recurrent rectal prolapse is also noted. Growth retardation and impaired cognitive function is also seen in severe forms of the disease. In case of heavy infection, there will be inflamed edematous and friable mucosa because of the load, because of the more parasitic load which are present in the intestine, there will be inflammation of the mucosal layer. There will be allergic response by the host, which also can be seen, that will be presented in the form of eosinophilia. We can confirm the allergic response by checking for eosinophilia. So coming for laboratory diagnosis, as I have told you the characteristics of the egg previously, they are bile stained. So you can see that color yellow colored, and they can float easily in the saturated salt solution. We can also detect the worms, presence of worms in the large intestine. There are some techniques through which we can tie it, make the person to engulf the capsule, it will go and attach to the end of the worm. Then when they excrete through the stools, we can see the worm in this form. Other findings which are like supportive are like peripheral blood eosinophilia and increased serum IgE level. This is mainly because of allergic response of the host. So treatment of the strichuriasis is, we can give mebendazole 500 mg once or albendazole 400 mg daily for 3 doses. Then ivermectin we can give, that is 200 mg per kg daily for 3 doses, which is safe but it is less effective. So usually we prefer albendazole or mebendazole. So this much if you know about strichuria, it is enough, and it may be your short note. So these all organisms will be dealt in next class. These are also your nematodes. Sorry for the inconvenience, as all the nematodes are in the same PPT, but today's class we have to take only Trichuris and Ascaris lumbricoides. So coming to Ascaris lumbricoides, it is also commonly called as roundworm. Again, because of the morphology of the worm, the common name is given as roundworm, and it is soil transmitted helminth. If you see the epidemiology of the parasite, it is a cosmopolitan in distribution, means we can see everywhere. It is not like in the temperate zone or freeze zones or nothing like that. It is a cosmopolitan parasite, mainly affecting tropical countries. It is also seen in India also. So this is how the parasite looks, and the name also suggests round. It is in the round shape. The head is present with this head, you can see. It has suckers kind of structures. This is the picture of egg. Here egg will be of different forms: fertilized, corticated egg, unfertilized egg, and decorticated fertilized egg. These are unembryonated eggs which will be passed in the phases. So this egg is very important, because most of your stool examination in your exam, which is a main exercise in your practical exam, you will find the Ascaris egg only, and there you have to differentiate which is which. You cannot write as Ascaris egg. You have to mention whether it is fertilized or unfertilized. You have to draw the morphology also. So this picture is very important for the practical point of view. So the parts are like, if it is unfertilized egg, there will be atrophidome. There are no other layers. Whereas in fertilized corticated egg, there will be lamellated albuminous coat. This rugosity outside, you can see that is the lamellated albuminous coat, and unsegmented ovum will be present in the middle of the egg, whereas in both the poles there will be crescentic space will be present. So this diagrams you can draw, it is very important in the practical point of view. Now we'll see the life cycle of Ascaris lumbricoides. So man acquires infection by ingestion of soil, food and water contaminated with embryonated egg. Okay, usually again the same thing like Trichuris trichura, it mainly gets infected with the soil, food or water which we take, and there are different phases here again. So it may be swallowed and it directly enters into intestine, or else it goes into duodenum. There will be different forms of larva again. There will be rhabditiform larva which hatches out from egg. Molting takes place. This larva penetrates intestinal wall, enters the venous circulation, goes to the right side of the heart. There through pulmonary capillaries it enters the lungs. Again in the lungs there will be molting, especially in the bronchus. Then enters the trachea and larynx, comes out through the pharynx, goes to small intestine. See, you can think like how it is, like it goes to intestine, again it comes to the circulation, then the respiratory system, then it goes to the digestive system again. It may directly goes to duodenum or it may directly goes to small intestine. If it is going to the duodenum, all the systems it will go touch and come back to the small intestine at the end. Again in the small intestine there will be molting, it develops into adult worm. So when there is adult worm, male will be, there will be a notch kind or curved structure, and at the end there are spicules. This is the male, whereas female worm is longer than the male and it has uterus, vulvar vest and intestine, everything will be seen in the proper manner. So there will be fertilization again, and the eggs may be of different types, fertilized or unfertilized or decorticated, any type it may be. So what happens, again this will develop or again change or transform into embryonated egg. They will be contaminated with the food or soil. This is how the life cycle takes place. So this parasite, it has different effects because it doesn't stay in one system, it keeps on migrating. So effect due to migrating larvae, you have to know. Mainly there will be pulmonary symptoms and eosinophilic pneumonia. It is also called as Loeffler syndrome. Loeffler syndrome will be your 3 marks question. So you have to name which parasite causes. There are different parasites which causes Loeffler syndrome because there are so many parasites which may jump from system to system. So you should make note. They may ask like 3 marks question also, name the parasites which result in Loeffler syndrome. So that time you have to write down the names. If they ask Loeffler syndrome, you yourself have to write, list down the organisms which causes the eosinophilic pneumonia and how it causes. This much you have to write. Then effect due to adult worm. There will be direct effect from the adult worm itself. Usually they will be asymptomatic. Then they may cause malnutrition and growth retardation. Intestinal complications such as acute pain abdomen due to small bowel obstruction. Rarely it may turn to perforation and intussusception. Extra intestinal complications can also be seen as this worm moves towards all the systems. So larger worms can enter and occlude the biliary tree, causing biliary colic, cholecystitis, pancreatitis, or rarely intrahepatic abscesses. These are all the extra intestinal complications. So coming to lab diagnosis, here first the mainstay for the diagnosis of the disease is stool examination. Under stool examination we have two types of mounts, that is saline and iodine mount, which detects three types of eggs. As I have showed you a morphology slide, there are all the three types you have seen. By seeing the morphology you have to classify them whether they are fertilized or unfertilized or decorticated eggs. Okay, this is the stool examination part. Then you can directly detect the adult worms, that is by X-ray. There will be trolley car lines. You can also perform USG and barium needle of GIT. This also helps in detection of adult worm. Next one is larval detection. Here you can take sputum or gastric aspirate in suspected individuals, and you can check for, again this is a microscopic method, you can check for larva. You can even do the serology for antibody detection, that is ELISA, IFA and IHA tests. Other findings such as eosinophilia and chalcot-laden crystals in sputum and stool are supportive evidences for our diagnosis. Coming to the treatment, there are anti-parasitic drugs which are usually given to treat and to prevent early potential serious complications. This is better to treat like a prophylaxis. We are going to do albendazole 400 mg once, mebendazole 100 gram twice daily for 3 days or 500 mg once. Alternate drugs like ivermectin and nitazoxanide are also effective. In pregnancy, if the individual is affected by ascariasis, then we can give pyrantel palmoate, which is safe in pregnancy. So, as Trichura Trichura, you have to note down the morphological forms of, first you need to write the introduction of the parasite, then you have to know the morphology, how many forms it raises. In ascaris, you have egg, larva and adult form again. So egg also three types, larval form, it usually there will be four moultings in the life cycle, that all forms you should know, L1, L2, the names are given as L1, L2 and all, that you should know. Then adult forms, male and female differentiation you should know. Then the life cycle which is the host, where and all there is moulting, how many moultings the organism takes place in the human host, and which is the diagnostic form, which is the infective form, you should know. Then you have to know the pathogenicity, what is the incubation period, what are the symptoms it causes in the patient and what will be the patient response also, like your eosinophilia and all. Then you should come for lab diagnosis. In most of the parasites, stool examination is the mainstay. You should explain about saline mount and iodine mount and other serological tests and rat detection of adult worm. If any USG or special tests are there, that you should write. And at the last, you can write the treatment. It is better to write about prevention also in case of parasites, as proper hand washing and prophylaxis in the endemic regions is very important to eliminate the disease. This you can add for all the parasites. So any doubts you can discuss in the group. You can feel free to ask the questions in the group as well. Thank you.